Assalamu alaikum. I would like to thank the Kalam Research and Media and the organizers for their effort in making this conference possible. It's a great honor and pleasure to be here. Is my voice is okay?
Prepare the back. Can listen? Okay.
As the title of my paper indicates, I will talk about the reception of Şer'l Akaid in Ottoman Empire, and particularly on its translation in the second half of the Ottoman Empire. And this translation is by Selim Sırrı Paşa, also known as Sırrı the Cretan. Some scholars argue that since Ottoman madrasas taught Eş'ari books, Ottoman ulema were Eş'ari, not Maturidi. Likewise, it has been argued that Maturidi thought was not as influential as Eş'ari. Nevertheless, Necmettin Ömer and Nesefi's work, known as Al-Akide al-Nesefiye, a condensed muhtasar risale, it became one of the most widely studied text in the Ottoman Empire. This creed, together with its commentary by Taftazani, became one of the main texts which was taught in Ottoman madrasas. Moreover, many Ottoman scholars wrote commentaries and glosses on this text. For instance, among the scholars of Fatih Sultan Mehmed period, Şemseddin Ahmet bin Musa, also known as Hayali, wrote an influential gloss on Şer'l Akaid. And it also became one of the textbooks. The translator, Sırrı Paşa, describes Şer'l Akaid as a work still in circulation among the ulema at his time. This reception of Şer'l Akaid in the Ottoman period is significant because this is evidence for the interest in Maturidi Kalam tradition. Perhaps this is why it was among many classical books that were translated and published in 19th century. Sırrı Paşa translated Şer'l Akaid when he was a state official in Danube province. It was published in 1875 in Rus. There are a few other Turkish translations as well, but this is the only one. This is the first published version. Just by scanning the text, we can see that Sırrı Paşa did not only translate the text, but also commented on it. It is, in fact, a commentary in the form of translation. Sırrı Paşa indicates that he tried to translate the text literally, but in some places he summarized various places from other texts. And he uses other glosses of Şer'l Akaid in the translation. In addition, Sırrı demonstrates a deep knowledge of the theological issues, as we can see from his notes and comments. These are interspersed within the text, and sometimes he wrote in the footnotes. Overall, we can see that Tercüme-i Şer'l Akaid is a text that goes beyond the original source by incorporating other glosses and support glosses and drawing on other theological and philosophical texts as well. Furthermore, Sırrı Paşa included views of contemporary scholars with whom he studied or discussed the original source, like the Mufti of Vidin at his time and Cevdet Paşa. As a result, we are facing with a rich text to study this tradition of Maturidi Kalam in the Ottoman period. So let me give you some information about the translator, which in itself is important to understand why a Maturidi text was being translated in 19th century. Selim Sırrı Paşa was born in town known Heraklion in the island of Crete in 1844. He traveled to Istanbul and there he got a madras education. Like many Ottoman scholars, he mastered both Arabic and Persian. After finishing his education, he started working for the government in different Ottoman provinces. At the end of his career, he became the governor of Baghdad and Diyarbakir around 1859. 90 and he died in 1895. As a typical 19th century Ottoman scholar, he was a widely learned man. He was a professor, a theologian, a poet, and a calligrapher. He composed and translated many books. These include his translation of tafsir books and his exegesis on several surahs. The most important is Ahsanul Qasas, an exegesis on Surah Yusuf. And in the field of Kalam, he not only translated Charlokait, but also summarized this translation and published as Naqdul Aqaid fi Naqdul Kalam fi Aqaid al-Islam. He also wrote a treatise on Ru'yatullah, and he has another book for the about the history of theological sects called Ara'ul Milal, and it's also worth mentioning his criticism on Christianity for in the book Nurul Huda liman ihtada. I think this is important because of at his time there were conflicts between Christians and Muslims in that region. So I go on with the content of the book. Sirpas Pasha's translation consists of one introduction and four volumes. The introduction is quite long. It's exactly 76 pages. And it's based on material taken from other books, like Şerhül Mevâkıf, Mukaddime, and Keşf-ü Zunun. He starts with presenting the historical background that which lead to emergence of Kalam. Hence, he provides a description of divisions among the Muslim community after the Prophet Muhammad's death. Sirri first discusses disagreements among the companions, drawing on the appendices of Şerhül Mevâkıf. He takes this part from the end of Şerhül Mevâkıf to the introduction of his book. So this reversal of organization, I think, is interesting, and I believe it indicates the significance of controversies among sects and religions at this time. So in this part, Jurjani says, when the Prophet died, all Muslims were in one creed and one way except Hippocrates. However, after his death, there began controversies among the companions. And Jurjani here reports from Al-Amidi, and he states there are five divergences, ihtilafat, for about the order for following the army of Usame, whether the Prophet was really dead or still alive, where to bury him, who should succeed him as the caliph, and another one, when the Prophet requested a paper in his deathbed. These are the main divergences first started. And this is followed by enumeration of seven big sects. These are misguided sects: Mu'tazilite, Shia, Khawarij, Murji'a, Najjariya, Jabriya, and the Mushabbiha. And the eighth one is the one who will be saved. This saved group is Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'a. And this issue stems from the famous hadith which predicts that the Muslim ummah will be divided into 73 sects. All of them will go to hell except one. The saved ones, Ahlus Sunnah wal Jama'ah, shared many agreed upon principles, such as the world is created, the creator of the world exists, and he is the only creator of everything, and he is eternal, etc. And a major issue concerning Ahlus Sunnah wal Jama'ah is the fact that it consists of two major sects. These are yani Al-Ash'aris and Al-Maturidis. However, in the history of Kalam, the Maturidi sect did not always receive a significant place, and its divergences from Ash'ari views were not emphasized. That is because Ash'aris and Maturidis agree on the major issues of creed, and that diverge on some minor points. So here, for example, in Mukaddime, Ibn Haldun did not discuss Maturidi Kalam. However, in its translation, Cevdet Pasha give further information in the place of Maturidism and its relationship with Esharism. And So here, Cevdet Pasha says that when we compare Eşari against Ehlul Bid'ah, Eşari, Maturidi is in, they consider it inside the Eşari. So Ehl-i Sünne means Ehl-i Sünne, Eşari means Ehl-i Sünne against Ehlul Bid'ah. But we put Eşari against Maturidi, Maturidi, then it began some ihtilafat, divergences, and one of the main important divergence is on the subject of irade, free will in humans, and which is called irade juziye. I will come back to this later on. And yes, I have to move fast. I want to add something about the book. Here, Sarı Paşa talks about other religions and other sects at the end of introduction. He took, as I said, from other books, but he also adds his criticism for Cevdet Paşa, but he also uses Cevdet Paşa as a source for the history of thought and history of philosophy and Islamic philosophy. I am skipping some parts. At the end of this part, he explains the history of Christianity from Tuhfetul Erib, Fi Red Ala Ehli Salib, written by Abdullah Tarjaman in 15th century. He's from Spain and converts to Islam later on. And he elucidates the Christianity's views and the differences between Matta, Luca, Marcos, and Johanna. And he adds on later on that if you want to learn the details of Christianity, you should read Isharul Haq, Isharul Haq by an Indian scholar, Kairavani. It was published in 1861. So this was also important because he focuses on the creed of Christians as well, and refuses the Trinity belief. So I will return back to the topic on human will. So as I said, this is from Cevdet Pasha's articulation of the issue. Here there are, as you know, there are two extreme positions. The first is Mu'tazilites, who believe that humans act freely and they are the creators of their actions. This thought leads to having multiple creators. This is the problem. And the second extreme position is that of Jebriye, which is the opposite of Mu'tazile belief. So Cebriye negated the free will, and they believe that humans are forced in their actions. But Maturidis criticized this. If Cebriye was accepted, this leads to having divine commands and obligations for human beings to be in vain. And Cevdet argues that Maturidis held the truth position here. And we can see how these Ottoman scholars, Sirri and Cevdet, they strike on the Maturidi thought. So here I try to d- describe the problem. Particular will, I will say. This is cüz'iye iradiye. Do I have time? Okay. This particular free will means that one could choose to action or not to action. The problem here is whether human will is created or not. Esharites believe that the free will is created, while Maturidites believe that it's not created. Accordingly, Esharites hold that everything occurs because God knows them, whereas Maturidites think that knowledge is derivative from the known. İlim maluma tabidir. Yutabiyor ilme malum. God knows events because of their occurrence in the future. To put it differently, events don't take place because God knows them. Rather, God knows them because they happen. And according to Cevdet, the most accurate and the best position of Maturidites is this. And he believes that Ashari will lead to determinism, and it will cause to Jebriye, if we accept that the free will is created. And Cevdet actually believes that this division can be reconciled by saying that desire is created. The introduction of irade, if we say it's created, this can be reconciled. And this it means that if it's created, it's existent, and whereas particular free will is not subject to time. And it's a state, I mean, it's a hal. So it is not existent, but it exists as a hal. It happens in a sudden moment in human sections. And it belongs to relational matters, umur itibariye. Okay, so I took this, and he then in the book he got this part from Akkirmani, who is also an Ottoman scholar. According to Akkirmani, this is his. So in the first place, there is a conception. He gives an example of giving alms. When someone wants to give alms, he first a conception, a tasavvur, and then he feels nefret, hate or desire. If he feels the hate, then he won't give the alms, but he wants it, he feels desire. And these both tasavvur and shevk is created by God. And they are existent. Then it leads to irade al-juziyye, particular volition. This is the hal. This is not created. This is from human. There he has to choose. He chooses and he moves his body, harekat al-aza. This movement, he wants to move, but then Allah creates the movements. So this is the last part. So I'll stop here. There's too much to talk about, but I think the issue is understood.
Okay,
so thank you.
Thank you, that, Aisha.
Thank you very much for this nice presentation. I would like to ask especially the Asharite position. So it is a general statement that the Asharites think the will, human will, is created. But what is the real root of this idea? What is written in the Asharite text about the will? I mean, do they make a difference between desire and the particular volition and say exactly this part is created, or just say the will in general is created? Can we open a door within the Asharite understanding for, how to say, a kind of freedom for the human beings in terms of the non-created aspect of will? Though there is a created aspect of will. I mean, what do you think about this?
Thank you for your comments and question. Asharis have the position, different position. They have theory of kasb. So they believe that God creates the actions, just we acquire them. So the action has two jihe. One way is to God, and the other way is to human. I mean, there are two point of view. If we look at from the point of humans, you acquire the action, but in from the point of God, it's created. I don't know if you add something else.
One more question, please comment.
Assalamu alaikum. I have two points. The first one is that we can say that the description of Nasafiya by Imam Taftazani, we would say that it's a discussion with the Maturidi. It's not an example of a Maturidi's book, because Imam Taftazani in many places, in many places in this book, he discusses the Maturidiya and say that Ashariya said that thing, the right is with Ashariya and whatever, in many, many ways. So I think that this sharh by itself is not an example of Maturidi school, I think. But after that, the way of Imam Taftazani, rahmallah, is somehow combination between the two madhabs, Ash'ari and Maturidi. Then after him, I think that who says that I'm Maturidi is just saying that there is a taqween or not. The Irad al-Juz'iyya, Imam Sa'd himself seems to say that there is something not created. I don't really remember that. But I think that he's saying by something by said by the Maturidiya and something said by Ash'ariya. But Sa'd himself, I can say that he's Ash'ari without any doubt, because his teacher, Al-Adud al-Iji, is Ash'ari, and his student, Ala'uddin Bukhari, is an Ash'ari, and he said that in his book, it's published. So if we are talking about Sa'd himself, I have a question that is, can we suppose that he is Maturidi at first? After him, who is teaching his sharh of Nasafi, can we say that they are pure Maturidis or not? I think that it's not that divergent between the two schools after Sa'd. I think that. I have a question now that, why his name Siri Basha? Why did he translate the Sharh al-Aqaid? Because I think there are many, ايش مصطلحات؟ terms, many terms there are in Arabic. So the students, when they want to study this sharh, they have to study it by the its Arabic meanings. So they have to study Arabic at the first. So what's the benefit of translating it to Ottoman? Thank you.
Thank you for your question. Yes, it's true that Taftazani is an Ash'ari, and when he explains Nasafi's statements, he sometimes puts his ideas among the lines, but he sometimes stays silent about the conflicting issues. As I said, there is not much difference. There's very little, very few points that they don't agree, but usually they agree on the general issues against Mu'tazilite and Jabriya, and it's controversial that, as I said, if they Maturidi or not, but I think Maturidi positions are heavier than Ash'ari for Ottoman period, and especially at the end of 18th century, with the modernization, they focus on Maturidi much more. Yes, and why he is translating the book, because he, at the end of this 19th century, 18th century, there are too much translations. Ibn Haldun's Mukaddime, as I said, translated to Ottoman Turkish, and they think that people who didn't study in madrasas, who they want to learn these topics, and as you know, there are when with the modernization, the madrasa, apart from the madrasa, there are other modern schools. So they want to teach other students as well these topics, and I want to also add that this when I look at the Mukaddime, this introduction of the book, when he explains the history of thought, he doesn't mention the modern thinkers, modernist, positivist, or materialist thinkers, because they were very influential at that time. Instead, he focuses on Christian belief in a Kalam book, and I found this one is interesting.
And thank you very much, Dr. Ayse, for the presentation.